Good morning, folks, and thank you firstly to Jim and to Mike for organizing this, as well as the Farm Bureau. They've been involved with setting this up. It actually came together very quickly, and thanks to Mike's initiative and Jim's help. It's a very timely topic for you guys, but what I'm going to report on is what we've been doing for the last 4 or 5 years. Funnily enough, in Maryland and on the East Coast, we have water issues too. We're mostly primarily water quality issues though, rather than water quantity issues. Of course, you have water quality, particularly with salinity. So I'm not going to assume any knowledge today from you guys. I'm going to really try and engage you. First of all, I just wanted to get a quick show of hands. Who's here from tree crops? So citrus, avocado. Okay, we knew that we were going to be a pretty strong contingent on that. Ornamentals, container growers, that type of production. Okay, great. Soil crops, vegetables, anything, any veggie folks in here at all? A little bit. We are doing some work on strawberries as well now. So I won't show any particular results on that, but I'll show you exactly what we're doing with that. What I'm going to try and give you today is the 30,000 foot view on this technology. How many of you have used sensor technology or used sensors in some, could be aerometers, for example, in soils? How many of you have used aerometers? Yeah, so a lot of you, right? How many of you are sick of aerometers? Okay, right. And why? What is the problem with aerometers? Any volunteers?
Too much work.
Of course, they are a very nice technology. They, for those of you who don't know aerometers, they tell you available soil moisture. And it's based on soil matrix potential. But in order to get that data, you have to put this a pipe with a porous cup in the ground, and you have to pull a suction. And of course, you've got sandy soils, you're always pulling a suction. Seems like every other day to get the data. And so it's hard, it's time consuming. So when we first started working on sensors, and I started off about 12, 13, 14 years ago now, we started off with some very technical stuff. I don't know if any of you have heard of time domain reflectometry. Anybody? TDR, yeah, okay. So TDR is great. In fact, it's what the soil physicists use and get data like that. Again, very expensive. It was very rudimentary at that point. The biggest hang-up, though, was getting the data. It's like trying to get data, you know, and it's, you can put all the equipment out there, but then you come back 2 months later and you download all the data. And he's like, okay, well, I've now got an Excel file. Okay, so now how many months did it take me to process the Excel file, right? So it's this timeliness of getting the information, that was the biggest challenge for us that we wanted to address with this project that I'm going to tell you about, because we collect data every day. You know, we're all connected, we're on data overload, quite honestly. The point of this is to give you data, but more importantly, give you information. And what one of our design goals with it, as I'll talk about in a bit, is that we wanted to, for anybody who was using this technology, to literally have a 5-minute decision window. You sit down with your coffee over breakfast, you look at your data, you decide what needs to be taken care of, you call up some managers, do it yourself, whatever it is, have your managers meeting, and you move on the rest of the day. Because if it's not like that, you're never going to use it. Okay. I'm going to introduce my team. I was very blessed to work with firstly, two things. Firstly, be funded by the USDA through the Specialty Crop Research Initiative. This was a five-year grant. I have a lot of very talented people in this group. A lot of advisory panel members. This is Steve Black. He's a tree grower. This is Terry Hines here. He's a big pot and pot, big container grower in McMinnville, Tennessee. I'm going to pick out all the important people. Well, this is Todd Martin and Lauren Bissey from Decagon Devices. But we had a number of graduate students and a number of cooperators in this group. Most importantly, just to give you an idea of the capabilities, we had lots of people working on different stuff. So we had the engineers from Carnegie Mellon. We had a big socioeconomic group, and I'm going to show you some of that data today. We had a great research team from the University of Georgia who were doing all sorts of stuff in terms of extension and outreach as well. So we had Richard Bauer, who is on software development, as well as David Kernbash. And so a big team, but a big team doesn't necessarily get you good results. I think what made this team work, though, was that we embedded 10 growers in this project from day one. They were not only our advisory panel members, but they actually guided the development of the software, they guided the development of the tools, and the approach that we took. Because we felt that we needed to be relevant. We can do lots of good research at universities and everything else, but exactly as Jim said, if you're not translating your results into action and impacts, then it's not necessarily a very good use of public money. So we felt, I throw this in now. I'll give you the website a little later, but we have a website up there which will show you the story, tell you the story of the project. But more importantly, we also have a knowledge center. So we also have learning modules in there. We're still building that, but we've got a lot of information there that will actually tell you about the background to sensor networks and some of the more detail. So this is the project website, smartfarms.net, and we've got a knowledge center up there. That's actually smartfarms.org. I'll give you those at the end of the session again. So what did I wanted to spend a little bit of time today, because again, I don't want to assume knowledge. I'm coming in from the East Coast. We have a very different set of crops, problems. But one thing I've learned as an extension specialist in the last 15, 18 years at Maryland is that every farm has a unique mix of issues. They could be time, labor, resources, being able to understand how you run a farm as a business and to optimize inputs is very much a reason that you do it. I mean, and so what all these tools do is give you more information, but more importantly, I hope that they allow you to actually optimize time. Because I know how important time is to you guys. You're very busy people. And running a business is very time consuming. And a lot of this stuff is very time consuming. I'm going to run through a little bit of the production environments that we've worked in. Why sensor networks? I think there's some real reasons why we want to do this. I'm going to describe the toolbox that we have. We have a lot of tools at our disposal. My analogy is, if you drive a Ford Focus like I do, then you need a certain set of tools. But if you've got a Tesla, then you're going to need a different set of tools. So it depends on where you are on that spectrum, what tools you decide you need to answer your problems. That's the nice thing about the toolbox, is that it's just like a car mechanic. You decide which is the most appropriate tool for your need, and then we put it together. I'll talk a little bit about the advanced sensor-controlled irrigation and the results of that. Part of the project that we did, in fact, as we developed this, it doesn't look like very much, but it's amazing how much time, engineering expertise, and thought went into this, into actually this little guy here, the relay. And so what we can do is we can hook that up to solenoids and flow meters. And this guy can be a latching solenoid, so it's independent of power. So this guy drives this based on sensors. So I'll describe how that works, but what's really interesting about that is less about the technology and more about how technology actually makes much better decisions than we do as humans. And I'll show you, hopefully I'll convince you of that with some of the data we've got. And then I'm going to finish up with a couple of case studies and the economic benefits, because I think what's very important about this is, yes, you can invest in the technology. What's really important is return on investment. Because if your return on investment isn't less than a year or two, and it's not good for you, then enjoy the day, enjoy your lunch, but it may not be for you, and that's fine. That's why, you know, you have a choice. Okay, production environments. I'm going to flip through this pretty quickly. If you have any questions, please just throw up your hand. What I do is I'm actually nursery and greenhouse extension specialist at Maryland. So I cover the gamut on a range of production environments. Tree, we have a big tree, field operations, mostly tree ornamental trees, quite high density. All of the operations I'm going to describe are all irrigated. And you may think, well, why do you irrigate in Maryland? You get pretty decent rainfall. Well, a lot of tree farmers don't necessarily irrigate in the later years. They certainly irrigate after transplanting, the year after transplanting, because that tree is in the ground for 4 or 5 years. If it doesn't survive the first year, it's a hole in the ground for the next 5 years. And it's lost money. And it's a lot of money just in one of these liners, because they come all the way from Oregon. Ship them to Maryland, put them in the ground, grow them, ship them out. So these are a big part of our nursery industry. In fact, the majority of the acreage in our nursery industry is in soil. But this is Terry Hines' operation in McMinnville, Tennessee. Terry was a field producer, but he's now growing. I'm not sure how many of you have ever seen a pot and pot operation. Okay, so few of you. So growing pretty big trees. Terry grows, his minimum container size is 10 gallon, but he grows up to 45 gallon pot, and that's a big pot. And the only reason that he grows in pots and not soil, well, two major reasons. Firstly, he doesn't like to export that much soil. He doesn't have that much soil to export, as in the old type of Berlin ball and burlap, so it's a sustainability issue for him. But quite honestly, it's all about the cost of freight. And because soilless substrates, we use pine bark and other soilless substrates, we call them, in this production systems, and they are about 10% of the total weight of soil. So it's all about shipping costs. That's why, that's the driver in this production system. Also, some producers are growing in a pot and pot because of wind. So they will sink a socket in the ground, put a pot in that pot, and that prevents a lot of blowover. Also overwintering. Tennessee gets pretty hard winters, and so it protects the root ball from above ground container production. However, we do have a lot of these types of operations. We call these container operations, container nursery operations, and this is one of our collaborating nurseries out on the Eastern Shore, very good nursery, Moon Nurseries. They have about 100 acre of containers, and as you can see, it's pretty complicated. Lots of different crops, lots of different water users, lots of different nutritional needs, and it's all jammed together because they're space limited. So it becomes a logistical issue now to understand how we can effectively water these crops and be efficient about it. Sorry, going backwards. One of the most innovative guys I've ever worked with is a chap by the name of Charles Bowers, who is a cut flower producer in Maryland, ex-dairy farmers. Charles and Richard, twin brothers, have been running a cut flower operation for about the last 25 years. They make a living out of an acre greenhouse. In fact, they've just expanded because Charles's son Matt has just expanded the operation. So they're now into sunflowers, cut flint sunflowers, but they've always been a cut antirrhinum, cut snapdragon grower. And as you can see, very intensive. very intensive operation. This is Charles here and Matt at the back. They are in continuous production, hydroponic, perlite. They were in bags, they're now in trays. They're growing about this much media. And they have about this much canopy on those cut flowers. And they have about this much flower. And it's all about optimizing the quality of that flower, but still keeping it happy with about this much a root. And so I will show you some data from Charles, because that's about our most extreme case. He's irrigating about 8 to 10 times a day. And he's now completely on machine-operated irrigation, because he just doesn't have the time to sit there and figure out when to irrigate. And lastly, we're doing a bit of work with a couple of strawberry producers now. Just a shout out to the Walmart Foundation. Yes, Walmart money is green. And so we are working this through the National Sustainable Strawberry Initiative. And we're working with a couple of growers in Maryland. I've got a PhD student who's working. This is at Butler's Orchard, matted row production. And this is Schlegel Farms, which is plasticulture. So we're actually translating this sensor technology now into strawberry production. And I'm very excited about that, because for the first time, I feel like I'm going back to my real roots as a physiologist, because when you talk about water, you talk about quality. And it's about fruit quality. I started off in citrus, did my PhD in citrus. I was in citrus for about 15 years. I know how water can affect the quality and the growth of citrus. And I know it's exactly the same for avocados as well. It's very critical at critical periods of the crop production phase. Of course, you guys are also dealing with salinity. And so when you deal with salinity, then you've got an osmotic problem, because your plant is taking a lot more energy to pull that water out against that salt gradient. So Mike, and we'll talk a little bit more about how you manage irrigation with regard to salinity. What's important about strawberries, of course, though, is, you know, if any tomato growers in the room, when you cut back on water, you're also cutting back on calcium uptake. And so then you get blossom end rot. So you've got all of these unanticipated consequences of cutting back on water. You want to be very careful about how you cut back and when you cut back, because it can greatly affect your crop quality. But let's concentrate on water. Because, anyway, well, irrigation's easy, right? All you do is open the spigot and close it off. What's hard about that? Well, as you all know, it's not easy. It's not about when you open the spigot, and that's, there's a lot of decision making. If you want to be efficient about it, there's a lot of integration of knowledge. Did it rain this morning? Yes. Well, maybe I can skip an irrigation today. Well, it actually didn't rain that much, did it? So it probably not, unfortunately. So that's okay to turn it on. You've got to integrate weather, crop conditions, crop growth, stage of phenology, everything else. Water is cheap. That is in eastern US, not here. But that's pretty universal. Labor and time are expensive. And many growers are still, quite frankly, on a manual system. Because why? Because you know it and it's reliable. You can rely on it. And you know, you can check up on the manager. So you know. But if you are on a time-based irrigation system, which many growers are, they've moved from, you know, there's stages in this irrigation. So you move from large-scale flood overhead irrigation to micro irrigation. Sometimes you're turning valves on and off. Maybe you've actually running copper wire, which in and of itself is a huge cost if you've got any size operation. But the default decision is still, do I need to irrigate today? And it's not typically very accurate. Put it this way, we are conservative. As individuals, we are conservative. And water is one of those things, when you compare it to the other resources you use, it's not worth cutting back on water unless you're very sure about that that's going to be okay. So, why sensor networks? Well, I think the nice thing about any information that if you can organize it well, it will give you information that you've never had before. How many of you have actually seen soil moisture data and have actually used soil moisture data? What do you use, ma'am? Just out of interest, do you use something? Do you use one of those sticking probes or
soil probe?
Watermarks. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yep. So you're pretty advanced. Oh my goodness. Okay. I feel for you. Pressure bombs are tedious. But how do you get that information? Is that information delivered relatively easily to you?
I've got data loggers, and a lot of it is
manual. Yep. So you're halfway there, because collecting the data is one thing, but actually taking that data and actually making it real time and actually giving you something that you can make an instantaneous or a relatively short-term decision upon, that's what we really want to talk about today. Because if you're trying to optimize water management, you've got to make timely decisions. What we're learning about this process is time matters. So what we're really trying to do is integrate this precision, drip, micro sprinkler, even sprinkler and overhead, that's fine, still relatively precise. But what we're trying to inject in this system is a decision component. Give you the tools to make an accurate decision. Because when you marry these two together, precision plus decision, that's when you get the true benefits of being able to really optimize your resources. So again, we work on the do no harm principle. We take incremental steps to implement the technology. We will monitor, maybe for at least a year, and we'll monitor different areas of a farm, because we like to engage the people who really know about the farm, which is you, the growers. You know your operation best. So it's best that we give you information, but we actually talk to you, because you know your farm, you know the placement, and it doesn't work if somebody comes in, puts in a sensor network and walks away, because that doesn't connect the dots. That doesn't connect you with the information. So these were our guiding principles. We need it to be cost effective. We need it to be efficient. We want that information to be easy to interpret. As I said, this 5-minute decision window, this is... My phone comes up, sorry. Gone to sleep. That's my 5-minute decision window, right there. Remind me later. Because if your eyes are as bad as mine, this doesn't work for you. But if you've got a tablet or something that you're connected to, this is being able to look at this information and actually see the data, actually on your smartphone, and be able to actually look at that data. That's a good thing to do. It's color-coded, and we'll get into this a little bit more. It's color-coded, so you set up those codes yourself. So green is, you can move on. Yellow, you need to take a look at it. Red, okay, spend a little time on the data. So we'll talk more about that with Mike. But this is an important slide, because I want you to really understand what a sensor network is. I can stand up there and show you, pieces of equipment, but it doesn't convey the story. So what this is think of this as a generic production area. Could be a vegetable, could be a couple of fields of vegetables, could be some blocks in an orchard, could be blocks in a tree. But basically what we're doing is we're taking these nodes, and at strategic places, we don't sense everything. We sense we sense those crops that you can translate that information to. So we work with you to position these nodes in that particular crop at a particular depth in the soil to give you the information that you need. That is then translated, or these, by the way, work on a, let me just describe what's in the box. A motherboard. It's battery operated, as you can see. We'll talk about length of batteries and how often those how long those last. But basically, this has a radio in it. It logs data from a number of different sensors. You can plug all sorts of different sensors into it. Those are situated in the soil or in the environment. You plug those in here. It will collect that data on whatever time interval that you want, and then it'll transmit that data. So this is basically, this is your kind of eyes in your field. But what really happens, the magic happens, okay, so this is the smart control that I'll talk about. So this one actually does, this one actually can control solenoids based on sensors. We'll talk a little bit about that later. But basically what these sensors do is relay this information to a base station on the farm, which is typically located in your office. But most importantly, that computer, we just connect it to the internet so that anywhere, wherever you can get internet, you can get your own data. So it doesn't matter whether you're in Taiwan or just down the road. So you can get your data. You can get that data. And more importantly, that data can communicate with you. So we can set up alerts, so we can be more sophisticated, so it can start pushing. You can set that up and it can say, okay, well, this particular node is pushing data to you. Yes, question.
These individual sensor areas, do they generally all need to be in an area that where they can receive cellular service?
That's a good question. No. So this is line of sight. These are typically what we can do if you're in a very hilly area. We can put repeaters, but what we found in the majority of cases is we run maybe a 25, 30 foot antenna up from your office, and if you know the distance, that will usually, these will transmit a mile and a half without any issues. 900 megahertz is really rock solid. The reason that we didn't do if you're familiar, and I don't want to get too technical, but they have other networks, they're called mesh networks. They are on a 2.4 gigahertz. Unfortunately, 2.4 gigahertz is frequency is affected by water vapor, and it's so the signal loss transmission is quite high. These are much more robust in terms of, although they do have a deficiency being line of sight. So if you're in a very hilly area, then we have to work in terms of being able to get line of sight. On the other hand, what Mike is going to describe is the 3G. Now this node actually goes straight up through the cell phone. And in fact, I'll show you, just move on to the next slide. So this is a project we have running in Ecuador for a community, and we're actually providing them weather data. And I can show you some pictures of these. These are pretty remote areas. So I feel like if I can get a 3G signal in the middle of the Ecuadorian rainforest, I'm fairly confident that I can get cell phone service in most places. Not everywhere, of course.
Can you mix and match?
Yeah. At this point, this is no. The 3Gs do not do the control at this point. But what Mike will show you is how we're using, how we've hybridized the 3G and we're pulling it down into the same software. So you could do a ground-based control, if I'm understanding your question, in some areas where you get good local service, and you could perhaps supplement, and certainly you can do that through the software. You can supplement in those areas where are really remote. And if you had good 3G coverage, then you could, yes, you can mix and match.
You can mix and match from the sensor point of view. So you can have sensors on line of sight, and you could have sensors on 3G.
Yes.
It's if you want to control the solenoids automatically that you need
line of sight?
Well, you don't necessarily need line of sight, Mike, but you need a good connection to your base station. Because your base station is now sending the command to the control nodes. Now these nodes literally do act as their own little autonomous. Once they've got a command, they're quite happy. They'll just sit there and execute that command, and they'll just say, okay, I'm on 25% threshold, and till you next tell them to do something different, they will do that, and they'll just keep on operating, and they're just happy as a clam. But it's the management which is problematic. Yes, another question.
So your sensors, your flow meters and soil sensors, are hardwired, or?
They are wired to the node. Yes. Yeah. Typically you can run those. Usually we run an array, and you'll see that outside. Jess has helped me set up some stuff. Yeah, we'll get into that. It's easier when we actually show you some stuff. So, but this 3G component. So this is kind of what I've described here as a hybridized system. So it could be, as you say, a mixture of the local telemetry plus 3G. We can certainly hybridize it this way. But what is really important is, and hardware is one thing. What the brains, what we call the intelligence of the system, is really in this, this software. And we put a lot of time and effort into this software as a project, because this is what this is the capabilities that the growers told us we needed to get in. So, okay, the analogy is we've got a smart toolbox. We've got a bunch of tools, but more importantly, we've got a range of sensors, got various moisture sensors, we'll talk about those, salinity sensors, but we've also got all sorts of different sensors as well. We've got pressure sensors, Mike is using these. To be quite honest, they work. I think we can do better, certainly with flow meters in time. But this inline tanky, see, that's actually designed to actually screw into a pipe. So that will give you EC coming in. This sensor will actually give you EC in the soil. So now you're measuring what you've got coming in on your water, or maybe your fertigation, and now you're measuring it below your root zone. So now you can start putting that data and that knowledge together about what your plant is taking out, the conditions of the plant, and more importantly, maybe what is building up in your soil, because then you might need to do a leaching irrigation. And then there's a whole range of environmental sensors. I have some catalogs here if you're interested in the whole range of sensors. But we actually typically like to put a weather station out on most farms, because that environmental information is kind of critical. It's not just about rainfall. It's about light. It's about temperature relative humidity. Because what we can start doing is we've got all sorts of tools, grow a degree day. So now we can get into IPM. We can actually start tracking insect development. So there's lots of things that we can do with weather station, this environmental, wind speed and direction, really important. I learned a lesson from our strawberry producers this year, because we're integrating a frost sensor for them to be able to understand the difference between weather station data and actually conditions in the canopy. So anyway, I didn't want to spend too much time on that, but basically that's the toolbox. Part of this toolbox, as I mentioned, was the node that we developed. I won't read it all, but basically what it is it has this relay. This is a prototype node. The commercial version of this node is coming out in a couple of months, and it will actually have the capability to run 4 relays. So now we can actually run 4 solenoids off one node, and it's informed from a number of different monitoring nodes. So we've got a lot of capability for a relatively low cost. It's getting warm in here. are we doing okay? Okay, all right. And maybe it's just me. I'm getting hot and bothered. But we will work through this. Mike's going to work through the software and the capabilities, because honestly, we want to make this stuff disappear for you. We want to actually get it situated right, but we want this is the stuff that we really want to concentrate on, because this is the stuff that we can then start interpreting your data to make better decisions. So, sorry, a lot of screenshots of the software. We will walk through that later. I included this because this is a very important tool that we developed as part of our research. And this is particularly for container crops, particularly as you'll see out here. Dustin, you'll be interested in this because, you know, those little bitty containers, if you're trying to irrigate them efficiently with a drip or a spray stake, as you know, you only put a little bit of water on it and it's right at the bottom. So this micropulse tool actually will pulse an irrigation in very short frequencies. We can actually get down to a 5-second pulse. It's not terribly uniform, because if you know an irrigation system, you've got all sorts of fill times and everything else. But for container nurseries, this was very important, because all we wanted to do is pulse that water on very gradually, 10 seconds, and then we'll measure it for a couple of minutes, and then if it needs to, it'll irrigate again. And that's all based on sensors. So we're literally pulsing the water on in very small amounts. Our biggest issue in the Chesapeake Bay is the amount of nitrogen and phosphorus we're leaching out and running off. And so we're under mandates to literally not do that, as you guys are in California. I feel like I can't teach you guys much about anything, because you've been living with it for 10 or 20 years as well, in terms of nutrient management. But it's a very simple rig. This goes out, box goes out on a pole this is at Terry Hines. This is a latching solenoid. Latching solenoids are great because they do release you from that running copper wire everywhere. So this then enables you to literally install that node, latching solenoid. We like to put a flow meter on it, because flow meter data is just amazing in terms not only of amount of water you're applying, but also for fault detection. Because you can use it if you get a break in a line, you can use it to send you an alert. So I just wanted to show you a snapshot of data from Terry Hines. This is what Terry used to do. Terry's a very good grower, even better irrigation manager, because he puts a lot of time and effort into it. How many of you have ever heard of cyclic irrigations? Okay, a couple of you. Cyclic irrigations are what we call a best management practice. It means that you take your daily irrigation requirement and you break it into 3 or 4 cycles. And so that's what you see here, 1, 2, 3, 4. Following the mantra, irrigate at 9, 12, 3, and 6 a day. And what that does is actually it increases your crop production, because very often if you irrigate once a day, you're irrigating too much. And then by the time 4 o'clock in the afternoon rolls around, that plant is out of water. It's in water stress. And so you've got no growth. When do plants grow, by the way? Any ideas? When do plants do most of their growing? What time of the day?
I heard it.
9 to 3.
No. 9 to 3 when? AM or PM? 9 PM to 3 AM. Probably about right. Why do plants grow at night? Because they've got enough turgor pressure. So they've come up to turgor at night. And so what happens when you divide cells, what happens, you only grow cells when you've got enough turgor pressure. So you actually have to have enough water in the plant for those cells to expand. The only reason I know that is because it's the primary principle in getting a citrus fruit from golf ball size to any reasonable size. If you don't have adequate water in cell expansion, you don't get fruit size. Okay. Of course, too much water can also be an issue as well. So what Terry was doing, though, is he was using 6-minute pulses. And so we quickly worked out, this is the control node doing its own thing. You notice that those lines are not sharp peaks now, and they actually don't run, they don't do much. It's like, well, you sure this is really working? Well, I'll show you the data. What's interesting is this is early April through to beginning of June. These are irrigation times. So this is minutes. So this is the irrigation length. So each one of these pulses is 1 minute. That's 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 4 minutes, 6 minutes, up to 8 minutes. That's the length of the irrigation duration. So what's going on here? You probably don't know dogwoods, but they are a very slow-growing tree. They're really hard to irrigate because I don't know what they're doing. They just sit there. But what's happening between April and June in Tennessee? What do you think is happening to that dogwood? I'll give you a clue. It's a deciduous species.
Leafing
out. Thank you. So, no leaves, leaves. And so what's happening is this control node is beginning to now, based on sensors, is now increasing the irrigation duration based on the demand of the tree for water. And that's mostly leaves. It's leafing out, it's using more water. It's typically growing like gangbusters in May and June in Tennessee because it's beautiful outside. You know, low humidities, may have some rain or not. That's a rain event. It quit. It's like, I'm taking a time out for a couple of days. I've got enough water in the soil profile. It didn't irrigate. So this is the automated irrigation capability that these nodes can do. So this is how it not only measures soil moisture, but it now makes appropriate decisions based on those data. So this is the bottom line. This was the grower schedule. This is Terry. As I say, really, really good grower. He's time-based, but he really tries to do as good a job as he can. Sorry, you can't see the colors, but this bottom squares. This is all the sensor-controlled irrigation. These are monthly totals, weekly totals on a liter per tree basis. And this was grower. So that was the difference between, and to give you actual numbers, that's the difference in savings. So we got about a 63% increase in efficiency based on that sensor. And as I say, Terry is a good irrigator. If I'm up against somebody who's literally turning on valves, I know I'm up in the 80 to 90% efficiency. That was the total, and that was total water from valves. So bottom line, what we learned about water conservation is sensor networks typically save water in four ways. Obviously, we've got different species. Different species use different types of amounts of water, and they do use it at different times of the day. It's very hard for us to understand what that is in reality as humans. What we learned from Terry is, in fact, the first 50% we saved Terry was reducing his irrigation durations from a 6 minute pulse down to a 3 minute pulse. And I'll show you some economic numbers from Terry. That really didn't make any difference to the bottom line, and I'll tell you why. So hourly, we can reduce those durations. On a daily basis, you're now matching that water demand to the plant, particularly on an afternoon basis. If you look at temperature data, most of the heat in a day is between 2 p.m. and about 8 p.m. There's a long residual heat in the day, and so plants go through an enormous amount of water in the afternoon and evening. And in fact, I think it's one of our primary issues in container production as nurseries, because what do? We irrigate early in the morning, and we keep our areas dry because we've got labor in them. And then we don't go back and irrigate them until the next morning. That's why I think we've seen startling reductions in production time. And then most, as you saw from the data, seasonally, it's the seasonal adjustment. Terry does a great job at irrigating in the summer. Very hard to beat him in the summer because he's really focused on that. Where we really beat him was on the shoulder season, spring and autumn, because it's really hard to understand how much water a plant actually needs in those periods of the year. A lot of stuff we've got published, that's all on the website as well. Just to finish up, I want to run you through two quick case studies. I know you're all Thank you for your patience. But I wanted to talk about network cost. This is actually published data out of Terry Hines. A lot of numbers up there. I'm going to actually skip through that. But this was a big system we put together for him. This was in total about $45,000, $50,000, but this covered a 300-acre farm. And it was kind of researchy as well. So we've learned an awful lot about how we can reduce the costs of networks in a few ways, which we'll talk about. Our economist, actually, Eric Lichtenberg, I have to do a shout out to Eric Lichtenberg, one of our economists, did a fantastic job on the economics of this. Basically, what we did is we amortized this over a three-year period. So about $14,000 per year on this particular network. I can honestly tell you that I've had nodes out of Steve Blackspace. I actually installed them in 2008. I'm sorry, I'm a very lazy researcher. I don't pull equipment out in winter. I just don't do it. If it doesn't last through a winter, a Maryland winter, I'm not going to put it out on a farmer's field because it's not worth it. So I don't pull stuff out of the field. These are entirely waterproof. I've had a few go out. Motherboards rust out on me if I get a leak in the box, but that's usually because somebody's left it open. I'll put a sprinkler on it. But the equipment lasts probably longer, certainly the nodes last longer, and the base station, everything else certainly lasts longer than 3 years. But the most important thing, what I really wanted to talk to you about, is the price of water. So in this particular publication, Eric did a plasticity of water. And in fact, I thought I had a better slide. That's the one there. So I'm going to use this slide. So it's exactly the same as the published data. But this is what Terry pays per 1,000 gallons. Now I've given you, sorry if you can read it.
Oh my God.
Sorry. Corresponding water price are per acre foot. So 55, 326, $652, $978 per acre foot. Okay. Cents per 1,000 gallons. So Terry's paying $55 an acre foot. That's because he's got a perennial stream at the bottom of his property, and his only costs are really pumping costs. So that's really about the price of his water, is purely pumping costs. What Eric did is he basically priced it out $1.23 per 1,000 gallons, and that equates to, I don't know what you guys are paying here, but I know it's up in this range here. Or out there, right?
Yeah.
Out there. Okay. So I want to, so the net savings, just go back to this slide, sorry, this here, for Terry, that $50,000 network had a return on investment of 2.7 years. It was a wash, pretty much. 3 years, break even. At that $3 a 1,000 gallons, the return on investment was 4 months for him. So that's what the plasticity of water, price of water, does on return on investment. He was using 50 acre foot per year on that farm. So I don't know how that translates to what you're using, but he was using a fair amount of water. He's very precise, put a lot of time and investment into running copper. He's got solenoids. He's on time-based control. He's being very precise, making good decisions. So not that much water. This is the startling number, because when you talk about annual net savings, now what Eric did is he factored in the cost of time and labor, it was basically just Terry's time, it was management time. What he didn't factor in, and this came out after this publication, Terry just told us about this, was really interesting. What we didn't capture in this analysis was that we saved Terry not his own personal time, we saved him clock time. So what we did is we created windows where he didn't need to irrigate. He had a set amount of water, and he runs 24/7, 9 months a year on his pump. And he's just going full out, just going round and round the farm trying to prioritize different crops. What we started doing is opening up gaps where he didn't need to pump and he didn't need to apply water. The net effect of that is he put another 30-acre block into production last year because he had the water to put that extra land into production. So I don't know what that adds into this whole these whole numbers, but I just wanted to tell you that. Lastly, Charles and Matt, father and son. Richard's also part of the operation, but he's more on the business side. As I say, small family farm, acre, hydroponic. Charles doesn't have a water problem. He just doesn't have a water problem. He's hydroponic. He's keenly interested in nutrient management because it's all about keeping these guys happy. But what he's really in tune of is how to reduce stress in his environment. Charles, for the longest time, has been scheduling irrigations based on integrated light. So he has a light sensor, and so for every accumulated amount of light during the day, that was when he would irrigate. So he was using an indirect measure, because of course light is a primary driver in plant growth, but it's not that accurate. You know, that was his background. This comes directly from Charles. In fact, when Mike and I last saw each other at Sealy last year, Charles was a part of our presentation. He put this slide together. This is what he's interested in. Identify stress areas in the greenhouse, establish and adjust irrigation schedules. This is the big one for him, particularly in summer. Summer is hard in Maryland because you've got very high relative humidities. It's hard to irrigate those plants, and his quality goes down in summer. And it's because of that accumulated heat stress and water stress. Disease is not a huge factor. He's had some disease outbreaks, but what we've really learned from some of our project partners is water management and disease management are intimately linked. Not only from a root perspective, what Charles had was botrytis. And so it was a gutation from his crop canopy increasing the relative humidity. And so it was, so he's had some, he's been able to really impact his disease. Equipment failures, just being able to literally know what's going on. And most importantly, he's really focused on reducing his labor cost. He's about as lean as the lean management folks should take a lesson from Charles. He's incredible. They produce about 500,000 stems of snapdragons. As I say, they've expanded. This is the greenhouse operation. They're now into sunflowers. I just wanted to show you this because this is kind of gets into the nitty gritty of actual scheduling irrigations with the software. This is what I call our macro scheduling tool. This allows you to then say to this node, okay, you can water anytime between 6 a.m. and 6 p.m. Okay, you got a window. Yeah, it's wide open. You make the decision. Typically, what we don't like to do is we actually like to be a bit more sophisticated, and we actually will split this into hour blocks, and we'll separate them out so you don't open a big window like this. But basically, it's the same thing. If you need to irrigate, you can irrigate. If you tell it not to irrigate, it won't irrigate. He typically stops early, this is summer, about 6 p.m. because he wants enough time to dry down before sunset. That's all about disease management, not about turgor. But this little tool here is really the micropulse, and this is that micropulse tool that I showed you just a little bit, where we can actually put that small amounts of water on the pot. And this is what this is a screenshot of Charles's operation. So this is this node running in automatic. Comes on at 7 o'clock. This, by the way, is flow meter data. So this is actually giving you flow meter totals, 7,210 up to He applied 50 gallons of water this day on that particular crop, on that particular bed. A pulse at 7, a double pulse at 8, took a time out because, as you can see, the soil moisture, by the way, we work on average sensor readings, not individuals, but it took a time out, did a double pulse at 11, I guess, took a time out, 1, 2, 3, see how much more water he's applying in the afternoon compared to what he's applying in the morning. And then by 6 o'clock, you can see from these dynamics that he's beginning to dry down here. This is what he actually wants. But note, it's a bit obscure here. He's got a very tight window here. He's literally working between 28% and 30% volumetric water content. He's in such a narrow window. He's using set point control exclusively now in his crop, just basically because he's seen the benefits. From an economic perspective, Eric did a big, really pulled teeth on this data to get pre-sensor data from all of their records and then post-sensor data in our study. This was the difference. And what's interesting is sometimes, you know, with different cultivars, this was actual percentages. Forget what this data is. Total stems. Thank you. It's a wash in terms of total stems or total cuts per bench, certainly with some of the cultivars. These are winter cultivars. This is group 1-2. This is spring, early summer, and these are summer cultivars in here. So we get a big bump in certain cultivars and other cultivars we don't. But this was the real payback because, again, he had a pretty large network. This is the breakdown. This is actually, Eric has published this now as well, breakdown in all of his resource use efficiency. Bottom line is that he increased his revenue and profit margins by about a third, pre and post sensor. I'm going to leave it there. There are, again, those URLs for some of our project impacts and our learning module there, but I think let's go and maybe, I don't know if it's time for a break, Jim, or questions at this point? Yes.
I would assume that technology has some value and it might be worthwhile for people to make that attractive to their taking it away unauthorized. In other words, theft.
Yeah. Well, I'm not quite following you. Theft in terms of actually just taking stuff off the farm?
People come on the property mm-hmm. and take yep. the notes and mm-hmm. take the stuff because it's electronic and it looks like it's valuable.
It could do.
Not be to them because if they don't have the complete system, it's not valuable.
Well, that's true. I mean, the hardware is one thing, but unless you've got the software, it really doesn't do too much for you. More importantly, I think what we like to do is, we've suddenly done some installations where security is an issue, and there are some ways that we can get around that. We can put stuff in lock boxes. This stuff you can put in a lock box and you know, just stick the aerial through it so you can actually secure it that way. But I also kind of work on the security through obscurity. So there's nothing to say you can't spray paint the case green and stick it in a tree. Probably won't do terribly well underground, Jess, but
you all season
you
add them under 6 inches of soil and end up
the nodes?
Not the boxes, not the nodes.
Oh, the nodes?
Really?
Yeah. Wow.
The miraculous
okay.
was all from
really? Wow. I've learned something. yes.
Have you done an economic analysis of how small the operation can be for that to be cost effective?
That's a really good question, and I think probably what it comes down to is net revenue. Net revenue. Because certainly in the nursery and greenhouse industry, the smaller the operation, what typically happens is that management becomes more intensive and net revenue goes up. But I think what I'm really excited about is this technology, I think, is probably priced to serve most small farmers better than it is large farmers in terms of profitability, in terms of actual return on investment.
I think you have the numbers. I don't know what the numbers of the pieces are these days. From what I've seen and the deployability of this, the installation he showed there was a very complex installation.
Yep.
Okay, it was a large farm with a lot of different crops. And so each of those crops needed sensors and control nodes and everything else. If you look at some of the smaller farms in San Diego County, one or two crops, one or two valves maybe run the entire thing or can run the entire thing. And so when you boil that down, it is very economical, in my opinion, at a very low level.
Yep.
In fact, you know, there's a whole application for this just in the landscape and yard market. You put this on controllers in your yard to control your landscape irrigation, the average homeowner, I'm going to save a boatload of water. Mm.
In fact, it's very
economical, in my opinion. And the more monocrop you have, where it comes down to is just diversity of facings and slopes and a few things like that.
The other thing is, his examples were nurseries and flowers as opposed to tree crops.
Tree crops, yes. Mm-hmm. Now we've done a lot of tree crops, not fruit crops or nut crops. But there are a lot of similarities between ornamental tree farms and just the mechanics of getting the data.
Yeah, but that's different.
Mm-hmm.
In the tree farms, the cash crop is trees.
Yep.
In an orchard,
it's fruit.
Crop is fruit.
No, I totally agree with you.
Different.
Absolutely, I totally agree with you on that. That's why I said, honestly, that the information that you get has to be married with the experience of the grower. First, because I would never do an installation where I went to control right off the bat, because I don't have that enough experience to know exactly, you know, if you're an avocado grower, exactly what your practices are to optimize that. So that's why I was going and monitor, in fact, learn from you, because that's You've got the eyes on the ground, you know your crop, you know best when to play that water. I always like to go in and actually look at what you're doing as a baseline and then understand how we can then improve applications.
I have one more question.
Mm-hmm.
Those nodes were sending information and data back to a central processing place.
Mm-hmm.
And the examples you used, they were all one farm.
Mm-hmm.
Will it work so that you would have separate properties geographically to go back into a central?
That's exactly, and that's the benefit actually of the EM50Gs. And in fact, Mike probably tell you, because he's got two different properties, and that it's that aggregation of data. It's just like we're doing in Ecuador, right? We're taking data from a wide area and aggregating it into a single database. It's very important.
Well, I'm not talking about aggregating. I'm talking about controlling it separate. So if you use the potential of the system,
mm-hmm.
and one property's here and the other property's 10 miles away.
Yep.
We have one set of sensors in the flower fields in Carlsbad. We have another set of sensors at the farm in San Luis Rey. And we can visualize and manipulate the data, and ultimately, we're hoping to get to electronic control, but we could theoretically manage the irrigation control on those two separate farms electronically from one location. Yeah.
The most important thing, though, at this point, we haven't hybridized the control between EM50Gs and these nodes. Certainly on the radar, though, because if we had these on one property with these EM50Gs, we can take this to the satellite, and then we could inform these, but at this point it's getting the data back down to this guy on the ground. That's what we got to, that's the thing that we got to sort out. But that's why we need the kind of the line of sight on the farm at this point, because we need a direct line of communication to this guy. We can't do it through the cloud. So that's the one hang up, I have to admit. We haven't quite got that there, but it's definitely on the radar.
One or the other, then the geography doesn't make any difference.
Geography is probably a limitation with these guys, particularly in here in California with topography. I think we can get around most, from what I'm my knowledge, I think we can get around a lot of situations, probably not all. We could certainly hybridize it with the EM50Gs. What I'd love to do is be able to connect these two guys together. Sorry, another question.
So is the API on your software open, or is it a closed architecture for your nodes?
I know the Carnegie Mellon guys always worked on an open API. Obviously, Decagon is our commercial partner in this, there's good and bad to working with a commercial partner, obviously. The good news is that researchers like me have absolutely no capability to actually scale this up to a commercial, to be able to offer it commercially. No university setup. That's why we had them in the project. The downside is, yes, they hold the patents. They're really a sensor company, primarily. They make extremely good sensors for a very cost-effective price. So they hold all the patents on the technology. There are many systems out there like Arduinos, and you can build. In fact, I can send you a publication from Mark Van Eersel, where if you had the time and capability, you could actually build your own Arduino-based node that will do exactly the same thing. You know, if you've got a smart 14-year-old kid, he could probably build it in 2 days for you. It's just like a cookbook procedure, right? But the problem is, when you start using those systems, is who's going to support them? So this is the critical thing. Decagon does a great job on support, but more importantly, for me, as somebody who's extremely interested in getting the technology out there, I think there's a layer, quite honestly, in there, in where, and we should really talk about this maybe after the break, is how we get. You can buy a box of stuff, but. And if you're smart and you're interested in it, you can deploy it, get it out there. We can certainly get you hooked up with the software and everything else. But it's like, okay, so what happens if something goes wrong? And I think that layer of support is very necessary, because quite honestly, I look at it in terms of dollar value of your time. And I don't know about your time, but my time is a certain price during the week, and it's double at weekends. Because we all want some quality of life, right? And so everything, I've worked on enough farms in my career to know that, I don't know what it is, but it's Murphy's Law. Sorry about the Irish, but it always happens at a weekend, right? It's always happening on a Sunday night or a Sunday lunchtime, when you least expect it. So having that support, having alerts and fail-safe systems, all of that stuff, I think, is very important to actually making these systems work well, personally.
If we can hang on our questions just for a little bit, we're going to keep powering through. Get to the next session. The blue group or the B group, as it's not getting the session list, is going to stay inside.
I'm going to take some sensors with me.
Or the A group is going to go outside.
Great. Thank you.
Sorry.